you just show your appreciation I don't know why they want to get out of God's world. The promised land is such wonderful weather we have here. You know, we're going to miss her. She knows that's where she's supposed to go. We certainly miss them. We've enjoyed being with us for the last few years. Bless you. All right. Let me get over the storm. Just a little review from last week with the two witnesses. The only witnesses God sends these witnesses to preach for 3.5 years. And they, there's the battle, it is, it might be Elijah and Enoch. Some people believe that they crossed back, either one died. And maybe Elijah and Moses because of the plagues. And it was Elijah and Moses that might have tried to figure out some. Because the Lord said he's coming back before Jesus returns in the second half. So, whoever it is, they're going to be preaching with power, and they are going to be the most hated people. These two witnesses are hated, and I believe that people will repeatedly try to kill them. Every time they try to kill them, then the people that try to kill them, they're the ones that get killed. You don't want to mess with that guy. Supernatural power to stop it from eating. Somebody messes with him. Okay, they're great in your brains. You know, you didn't want to mess with those people. They get turned over to blood. You know, some of these things in the Bible said the plagues of Egypt and the Old Testament. And they're going to be preaching. And until God says that's enough, that he already has that preordained, how long they'll preach. At the end, the Antichrist will be allowed to tempt them. And he'll kill these two witnesses. And the world will rejoice. Everyone's watching. They see these guys and they see that they're dead and they're dead in the streets. Their bodies have been lying in the streets for 3.5 days. Is that crazy or is that crazy? And during that time, there's a party going on. People are exchanging gifts. We think it's Christmas time. It's rejoicing. It's only time on earth that's rejoicing in the tribulation. It makes us apart in the Bible. But then, after 3.5 days of lying in the street, their breath comes back into their body and they stand up. You can imagine how quickly and abruptly the parties have stopped. Everybody's shut up, they're in fear. And then, after they they ascend to heaven again. The world is watching. This is bizarre things. The whole world is watching as these two witnesses go up into heaven. And then, before they catch their breath, then there's an earthquake on earth. And a tenth part of Jerusalem is destroyed. 7,000 people died from that earthquake. I mean, it's some crazy things going on. Bible says that two woes are over, and now it's time for the third woe. The trumpet sounds here at the beginning of Revelation 11, and the events of the past are going to be recorded until Revelation 15. When the seventh angel blew the trumpet, there is an announcement of victory. I mean, there's rejoicing. Why is everybody rejoicing? Because the Lord is taking over. He's taking over the throne. But yet he's not taking over yet. He actually doesn't officially take it over until he comes back. Until the Lord Jesus comes back, sets up the millennial kingdom. So what we're doing, we're looking ahead. So let's say, I told you there's special reasons for rejoicing on the back of your book. Stand with me in the word of God's word. Look at me in verse 15. And the seventh angel said, there were the verses in heaven saying the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of the Lord that is Christ, and he shall reign forever. That was the inspiration for Handel's Messiah. And we've never heard Handel's Messiah. That's the inspiration right there. It says the 420 elders were set before God, and their seats fell upon their faces. This is a church worshiping God, saying, we give thee thanks, Lord God, which is all the ones that are to come, because thou hast given to thee the great power and his reign. And the nations were filled with thy wrath is coming in the time of the dead, that they should be judged, that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants, the prophets, and the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, shouldest destroy them, which destroy the earth. And the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there were seen in the temple of the ark of the testament. And there were lions and voices of thunderings and earthquake and a great hail. Thank you. Be seated. You see the great forces in heaven, no doubt, the choirs of heaven singing in victory. The great announcement is that the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Christ. That's the announcement. And looking ahead, looking ahead right now as we look at this, to the very edge of eternity, where the Lord takes possession of the world, and there's rejoicing in heaven. And there's only 3,000 people on the earth, and there's rejoicing because of a ruler. There's rejoicing because of a ruler. His name is Jesus Christ. And I'll spend my time on this number one because that's just the way I believe I should be. Jesus is taking possession of the ruler that was lost to sin and Satan thousands of years earlier. God gave man dominion of this earth. And we, man, blew it. We traded it off. We sold it. And we tried to get more. Just like Satan sold it out of heaven. It got kicked out of heaven. Man did the same thing. And so, you know, there's always been rulers on earth. There's been kings, there's been emperors, there's been presidents, and so forth. That's all part of this. We all know heads of countries and nations around the world. But they haven't really been ruling. You see, Satan is the ruler of this world. Satan is the ruler of the earth. Satan is. He's called the God. This is the G-O-D, and he's the God of this world. 2 Corinthians 4, 5. Jesus called him the Prince of the world 3 times. He's the Prince of the world. And he's in charge of this world, and we'll get to this, to a degree. How do we know it? And one of the ways we can see the truth of Satan's rule is seen in the hatred that's leveled towards Jesus. I mean, think about it. Why do people hate Jesus? Have you ever asked yourself that question? Why do people hate Jesus? And they do. They don't want to hear his name. They don't want the mention of his name. If they say that, complain of his name. Take Jesus out of the school. Take Jesus out. Take all that out. Why? Think about what Jesus did. He just worked out loving on people, helping people, healing people. People that have never seen the great meal that have been so they can see. People that have never heard before, and he healed them. There's places in the Bible that says that Jesus healed all that came to him. I mean, the masses would come to him from town to town, village to village, and he healed them. I mean, who do you accept like that? Not only that, he died for us on the cross. I mean, that is a passage in the Bible. He died for you and me. Why did he die? So that we could be forgiven our sins, so that we could have everlasting life. I mean, we're all sinners, let's face it. We're all in the same boat. We're all in sin, control the Word of God. And the wages of sin is death, eternal separation, not just physical death, eternal separation from God. That's what we need. God demonstrated, he commended, he showed his love towards us, and that we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Praise his name. Well, is that a reason to hate him? No. So why do people hate him? Because they're very mind, their land, by the devil. There's two kingdoms. There's a kingdom of light, there's a kingdom of darkness, and just be right there. Every single person is either following or is in the kingdom of light or the kingdom of darkness. The majority of the world is in the kingdom of darkness, the following Satan. People that don't even know if they're following Satan. People that would say, I don't even believe in Satan, or I don't believe in God. If they say, I don't believe in God, they're following Satan. They're following the God of this world. A dad went to a toy store and purchased a toy for his son, and they brought it out, and he was like, well, I don't know, look at it. So he opened it up. With so many parts. Have you all been through that before? And I'm going to ask you, but he gets the directions and he starts to get through it. And then he realizes this is contradictory, this is convoluted, this doesn't make sense. And so we call the manager over and said, this doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense to me. It doesn't make sense to my father. I hate you. This doesn't make any sense. And the man said, oh, you don't understand. This is an educational tool. No matter how you put it together, it's wrong. Or it's right. You see, you can't do it like this. But you know this, what is being pushed in our world today? There's no rights or wrongs. This is what you believe. You don't want to do it. You believe for what you're doing. There's no right or wrong. So how can you be a right? I don't know if I'm wrong about something. It's not for you. It's wrong for me. It's too late. You know, there's no truth. What is a woman? Anybody see that documentary? What is a woman? Make a house. I encourage you to watch it. One of the things that just jumped out of me was a professor, intellect, who got furious when Matt Wallace would ask him, just ask some questions about truth. He got furious. Truth. You see that there? He didn't know. He just livid over the word truth. You know what that's coming to? Jesus said, I don't have anything to do with it. That's just what you think. That's what you believe. You see, so the world is following Satan. It's moved away from, and certainly trying to move from any truth whatsoever. The world is led by Satan. It is convoluted. It is chaotic. It is corrupt. It is confusing. And it leads to destruction. That's exactly what we're saying is the end of this world. The destruction. You take the New Age teaching of evolution. You know what? Billions of years, everything just came together. This big bang and everything, billions of years, it just kind of came together. It's a beautiful, different thing that maybe just happened to come together. But see, here's what New Age teaches. It's the teaching that over time, long enough, we become, they think we're there. We become God. And then I'm going to say, you know, there's a lot of people play that already. What would we be? Be God. Well, I will say this. A lot of people are acting like God. Do you think they're the ones calling the shots? Do you think they're the ones that are determining and saying, I know as much as this, I know what I'm going to do. I believe this. I believe this. I believe this. What are you doing? Where's this coming from? I want to give you some good news today. This beautiful woman reminded me that a high school football coach had a constitutional right to pray at the 50-yard line after his team's games. It's the latest step in the court of expanding the place of religion in public life. However, there's, just to give you just a touch of science representative Susan Wahada, Democrat from
seek to guard this decision by Supreme Court in prayer to the Taliban. This is what she said publicly. She brings it to the Taliban. Am I mistaken, or is it the Taliban that can kill those people who don't subscribe to their radical Islamic ideology, including Christians? Isn't it the Taliban that terrorist organization that commits mass murder and rape and often employs suicide bombers? Isn't it the Taliban that forces women and girls to marry soldiers, including cow brats? It's the Taliban. We're talking about a man that decided to just be a man silently. What is all this? There's some crazy stuff going on. Following Satan. That's what's going on. They're following Satan. They're leading on Jesus. They're leading on Christianity. They're leading on the gospel. And that's exactly why they're following. They're following Satan. They're not helping them in this world. Well, I guess some good news for you. Satan's kingdom is not going to last forever. Jesus' kingdom will, look at verse 15, he shall reign, and underline in your Bible, he shall reign forever and ever. Every person who shall reign, every ruler, every king, every president, they have a period of time in his life. Some things will stop, but the Lord's is forever and ever. Psalm 5:13 says that kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and that the dominion endures throughout all generations. Is the Lord. I bet this in your notes. Satan is a finite, limited, created being. He can only rule within the limits that God allows. He's limited to God's providence and sovereignty and purposes and power. All right, so let me move on. There's a true thing that calls for ruler. His name is Jesus. We're just looking ahead. And then, secondly, there's a true thing that calls of a reward. Verse 18 says, when the nations are angry and the wrath is coming, turn the dead, and they should be judged, and then thou shouldst give reward unto thy servants, the prophets, to the saints, and then the fear thine acts, only will exist for them which destroy the earth. Again, the world needs Jesus, and they demonstrate the will of him straight when he comes. When he comes, and the armies of the world will be gathered against Jesus. And he will destroy them. He will destroy them. The nations, it says in verse 18, angry. Do this real quickly. A whole place in Revelation 11, turn to Psalm 2 in the Old Testament. We'll read 3 or 4 verses real quick. Psalm 2. Give you a second to find it. Where it is right after Psalm 1. Look at Psalm 2, verse 1. Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? Why do the people rage when the heathen rage? Why do they rage for the reason against God? Why do the people rage against God? And the people imagine a vain thing. And they have a hopeless plot against the Lord. Why do they do that? It says here in verse 2, the kings of the earth, 7,000 rulers, they counsel together, and now you are the rulers against the Lord. If you start suffering some persecution, just understand this right here. It's against the Lord. It's against the Lord. And against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from the temple of Zechariah. Let us break their bands asunder. Here's what it is, y'all. Let's break the chains of Christianity. And we'll break that. Let's break that. That's what people are trying to do right now, even in the United States. We'll break that. We'll get rid of that. Okay? See, the most horrible fruit of the Lord that they first fall. He that sinneth and leaveth shall wrath. The Lord shall have an indication. The Lord disliketh their clean plans. Now, these people are still standing against God, but they're dealing in sins. Staying against Almighty God, and his love, and the people of the earth. This is ridiculous. This is crazy. This is silly. Well, we will, while the lost sinners will face the Lord's judgment, faithful believers will be. But this includes every act of devotion to Jesus will be rewarded by him. Nothing is so small that he doesn't see it. Every sacrifice you've made, everything you've done, every time you pray, your conviction, your conviction will be rewarded for that. Be faithful in church. You'll be rewarded for giving and tithing. You'll be rewarded for that. Faithful to serving, for trying to witness to somebody, you'll be rewarded. Doing a good deed, you'll be rewarded. Now listen carefully. As long as it's done for the Lord, to follow the Lord of the Lord. You see, if you do a church, if they have to make a living, that there's no way I can pray all the time, I can sing, I can give, and serve, and then I not get any reward from heaven in heaven. If I'm doing it selfishly, I'm doing it to be seen. I'm not doing it to be heard. If I'm doing it for selfish reasons, it's the devil. According to the Lord, it says, I'm going to have my reward. Well, you need to have that. Good job. Oh, I noticed that. That's it. That's your reward. That's all you need to get. So this is very important. These rewards, you give them away, and you get the money on the seed, and you get the things in here. That's what you get experiencing. A lot of these rewards that we have will be rewarded in the millennium. But we do need to examine ourselves and others. Do the summer holidays while working as brothers at school in Old Kingdom. And as a Christian, some books go to do, and again and again, and take them. He comes to, he knocks on the door, and he gives a kid to comfort. Did you please get me? He was just thirsty and tired. She said, I'm sure. She said, if you're not going to get your big piece of cold milk, I thought you would be great. And you know, he enjoyed it with the best he ever had. But for 3 years, he graduated. What? You and I can never pay our sin debt. Jesus and repent of sin and turn to Christ. 100%. Paid in full. Isn't that awesome? And then, this is above that. This is really that's where I'm going to get from you. In his name. Was there any? Let me come to the right part. The third one there is rejoicing because of redemption. There's always rejoicing because of redemption. What is redemption? We can use that term very much. Here's what it means. That's the word. The word redeem means to buy out. That's what it means. And the connotation here is inflicted by the slavery. The teaching here is a reference to purchase someone of slavery. You purchase their freedom. We were all slaves. Every one of us had been slaves. Slaves to what? Slaves to sin. He was a slave, folks. He was a slave. Now talk to me about slavery. He was a slave. He was a slave to sin. Matter of fact, the Bible says he was dead in the trespasses and sins. He was following the leader. He was following Satan. That's where I was. I was following Satan. You ever been a Satan follower? Yeah, you have been. Whether you know it or not, you were a Satan follower. Before you came to Christ, you followed the God of this world. Every one of us did. And everybody that hasn't come to Christ, they're still there. And then you come to a place where you either say yes to Jesus, I want to be saved. I want forgiveness of my sins. And if you don't say that, say, maybe later, man or whatever, I'm not interested. And then you'll continue to follow Satan all the way to destruction. The Bible says Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. You may have cursed folks. There was fitting as a lawyer, actually, was in law school. And one day he was about to finish, and one day he was there. Office by himself. It seemed like God spoke to him. And he asked him a question. He said, God asked Finney, what are you going to do when you get out of law school? Finney said, I want to start my own law practice. Finney, what are you going to do after that? Do after that. Story. A man in Chicago had a sweet little daughter. In fact, there was this wife, his little girl was this wife. He loved that girl more than anything, more than anybody, more than everybody, more than he has put together. He loved that little girl. And she was his reason to get up in the morning to go to work, to live, was his little girl. And God took away that little girl. She died. Everything he tore things down. He just hated God with every fiber of his being. He hated God. Matter of fact, he was about to go into Jesus Christ. He just thought it was a good thing. And he is clear. He was standing by the river. Beautiful. She's standing by the river. And then the second word, singing. It was beautiful singing. And he's just standing there. Then all of a sudden he sees some people coming on the other side of the river. He's still not singing. And then he's getting a little closer. He realizes these children. He says, listen, it's gorgeous, it's beautiful sight. And he's coming closer and closer to the river, on the other side of the river. And then all of a sudden he sees his daughter is in front of him. Then he hears her say, Daddy, come over here. Daddy, come over here. And he didn't close by anymore.